everyone, welcome to my YouTube channel Pharmacy Made Easy. Today we are discussing some multiple choice questions from different sessions of pharmacology. And before going to the session, I would like to say a lot of thanks to each and everyone for supporting me this much, and thank you so much, and I'm welcoming you all to our family. Today we are going to discuss some multiple choice questions for pharmacist competitive examinations. That means I will be discussing some objective kind of questions. Today I am discussing only or focusing only on 5 questions. Okay, so what I am going to do is I am not only focusing the answers, but also there will be 4 options for each and every question. So I am going through all that options, so you will get familiar with that options also. With that answer, you are studying much more and you are getting much more information. And I hope this will be an easy interaction for you guys. And if you have any doubt, don't forget to comment that in the comment box given below. And this will be very helpful for those who are preparing for various competitive examinations like GPAT, NIPER or DHA, HAAD and other pharmacist competitive examinations. So here we start our session. First question, which of the following anti-angiogenic agent is a calcium channel blocker? Option A, nitroglycerin. Option B, dipyridamole. Option C, minoxidil. And option D, nifedipine. Once again, I am reading the question. Which of the following anti-angiogenic agent is a calcium channel blocker? Option A, nitroglycerin. Option B, dipyridamole. Option C, minoxidil. Option D, nifedipine. So the answer is nifedipine. But before going to the answer, we have to understand what are anti-angiogenic drugs, and among that, which are the calcium channel blockers. Angina pectoris is a sudden severe chest pain that occurs due to insufficient coronary blood flow to meet the oxygen demand of myocardium, and finally that will lead to ischemia. So myocardium means it's a muscular tissue that's found in middle layer. That means heart's middle layer is myocardium, and the oxygen demand of myocardium, to meet that oxygen demand, there will be a lesser blood perfusion will be there. So anti-angiogenic drugs are used to decrease this oxygen demand of myocardium by altering blood pressure, heart rate, contractility, etc. Here we are coming to the classification of anti-angiogenic drug. The first important category is nitrates. Among nitrates, there are short-acting nitrates and long-acting nitrates. And in short-acting nitrates, the main example is glycerin trinitrate or nitroglycerin. And long-acting nitrates include isosorbate dinitrate and isosorbate mononitrate, etc. And the second category of drugs used for angiogenic treatment is beta blockers. And it's mainly include propranolol, metoprolol, atenolol, etc. And the third category of drugs used include calcium channel blockers. And among that, there is 3 different categories. First one, phenylalkylamine. Example, verapamil. Second one, benzodiazepines. Example, diltiazem. Third one, dihydropyridine. Example, nifedipine, amlodipine, etc. And the fourth category is potassium channel opener, example nicorandil. And the fifth one, others, that means other drugs which are used as anti-angiogenic medications, example dipyridamole. So the main important category is nitrates. Okay, so the categories include, once again I'm saying, the categories include nitrates, beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, potassium channel openers, and there are some other drugs. So in this, the question was, which of the following anti-angiogenic agent is a calcium channel blocker? So here we are going to discuss in detail about calcium channel blockers. So as we seen in the classification, there are three categories of calcium channel blockers. First one, phenyl alkylamine, example verapamil. Second one, benzothiazepines, example diltiazem. Third one, dihydropyridines, example nifedipine and amlodipine. We know when calcium enters into muscle cells through voltage-gated calcium channels, this will cause the release of calcium from sacroplasmic reticulum, and this will lead to increased cytoplasmic calcium levels. So what this calcium channel blockers will do? They will inhibit the inward movement of calcium by binding to the calcium channel receptors, and these calcium channel blockers that mainly act on receptors that found in heart and smooth muscles, and they cause vascular smooth muscle relaxation and dilation of arterioles, because calcium is required for contraction of muscles. Here calcium channel blockers block the calcium channel, and as a result calcium ion cannot move inside the cell. So as a result, that will lead to relaxation of muscle and arterioles. Calcium channel blockers are effective in treating hypertension in patients with angina or diabetes, and these calcium channel blockers are mainly arteriolar vasodilators. And calcium channel blockers, there are three different categories. First one, diphenyl alkylamine, example verapamil. These have effect on cardiac and vascular smooth muscle, and this verapamil has much more effect in cardiac muscles, and they are mainly used in angina, then supraventricular tachyarrhythmia, and also in migraine headache. The second category is benzothiazepine, example diltiazem. And this diltiazem has same effect as that of verapamil. They have effect on both cardiac muscle and also in vascular smooth muscle. The third category is dihydropyridines, example nifedipine, amlodipine, nicardipine, etc. They have more affinity to vascular calcium channels, so they are more particularly useful in treatment of hypertension. Okay, so when comparing these three categories, the first one, verapamil, has more effect on cardiac muscles, and third category, nifedipine, that has more affinity for vascular calcium channels, and the second category, diltiazem, they have an intermediate activity. They have both effect on cardiac and also vascular smooth muscle. And main drug used for the treatment of hypertension is this third category, that is nifedipine, amlodipine and nicardipine, etc., the dihydropyridines. And for angina and supraventricular tachyarrhythmia and migraine headache, the main drug used is verapamil. So that's all about calcium channel blockers. So we are going back again to the question. The question was, which of the following anti-angiogenic agent is a calcium channel blocker? Option A, nitroglycerin. Option B, dipyridamole. Option C, minoxidil. And option D, nifedipine. So now you can find out or choose the answer, the correct answer from the option, and it is nifedipine. I think it is clear for you. If any doubt is there, please comment it in the comment box. Now we are coming to the other options. Option A, nitroglycerin. Nitroglycerin is an organic nitrate It's also called glycerol trinitrate that will cause vascular smooth muscle relaxation. And also that they will decrease the myocardial oxygen consumption. Then the second option, dipyridamole. Dipyridamole is also a coronary vasodilator. Then the third option, minoxidil. Minoxidil is also an arterial vasodilator that causes dilation of arterioles but not veins. So it's a purely or selective arterial vasodilator. Let's move to the second question. Which of the following drug is an uricosuric agent? Option A, allopurinol. Option B, sulfinpyrazone. Option C, colchicine. And option D, indomethacin. All these drugs are used for the treatment of gout. So gout is a metabolic disorder characterized by high levels of uric acid in blood, and these urate crystals will get deposited on joints or kidney as sodium urate, and this will lead to migration of inflammatory mediators, sometimes like leukotriene etc., into this area, and that will lead to an inflammatory reaction. So we will get a lot of pain in that area and infection and inflammation etc. So that is all about gout. And the drugs mainly used for gout, there are two conditions, for acute gout and for chronic gout. Before that, the main therapeutic strategies of gout include, first one, interfere with uric acid synthesis. And this gout always preceded by hyperuricemia, that means increased amount of uric acid in blood. Okay, so by interfering with this uric acid synthesis, we can decrease the concentration of uric acid. And the main drug used for this case is allopurinol. And the second therapeutic approach is increasing uric acid excretion. Okay, these agents are called uricosuric agent. So they mainly act by preventing the proximal tubular reabsorption of uric acid. Thereby, they enhance its excretion. So the examples for this uricosuric agent include probenecid and sulfinpyrazone. Okay, in proximal tubular region, that mainly associated with tubular reabsorption. So here the uric acid will be reabsorbed by a urate anion exchanger. So this uric acid agent will inhibit this exchanger. There is a urate anion exchanger. So that by thereby they will promote the renal clearance of uric acid, as uric acid is not reabsorbed. So that's what uricosuric agent, example probenecid and sulfinpyrazone. And third important strategy is inhibiting leukocyte entry into affected joint. As I said earlier, when this uric acid crystals deposit on joints or kidney, that will lead to migration of some inflammatory mediators into that affected part. So that will lead to some inflammatory reaction. Okay, so this agent will inhibit the leukocyte entry into affected joint. Example, colchicine. And the fourth approach is administering some non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. NSAIDs, example, indomethacin. So this is what the major therapeutic strategies of gout. And there are some drugs used for acute gout and also for chronic gout. And the drugs mainly used for acute gout include NSAIDs, colchicine and corticosteroid. Second category, the drugs used for chronic gout or hyperuricemia. In that, the first classification is uricosuric agent. Example, probenecid and sulfenpyrazone, and second category is synthesis, uric acid synthesis inhibitor, example allopurinol. So this is what all about the classification of drugs used in gout. And we are coming again to the question, which of the following drug is an uricosuric agent? Option A, allopurinol. Option B, sulfenpyrazone. Option C, colchicine. Option D, indomethacin. In option A, allopurinol, that will interfere with uric acid synthesis. Option C, colchicine, that will inhibit the leukocyte entry into affected area. And option D, indomethacin, it is an anacidin, that is an anti-inflammatory agent. So option B, sulfenpyrazone, that is a uricosuric agent that will block the proximal tubular reabsorption of uric acid and increase the clearance of uric acid. Here the answer is sulfenpyrazone, and I hope it's clear for you. If there is any doubt, I'm again saying the same thing, please comment it in the comment box. The third question is, tick the drug inhibiting viral reverse transcriptase. Option A, sidovudine. Option B, vidarabin. Option C, remantidine. And option D, ganciclovir. So all these drugs are antiviral agents. And the question was, the drug inhibiting viral reverse transcriptase. Okay, so this viral reverse transcriptors, these are mainly used for the treatment of HIV. So before going to that, we can see what are the antiviral drugs. So there are different kinds of antiviral drugs are available, and the classification, first one, for respiratory tract infections, that's mainly against influenza A and B, example amantadine, remantidine and ribavirin, etc. This ribavirin recently that's used in against Nipah virus. Okay, the second category is for hepatic viral infection, and the examples include lamivudine, telbivudine, adifovir, etc. And the third classification for herpes and cytomegalovirus infection, example acyclovir, ganciclovir, foscarnet, vidarabin, etc. Then the fourth category is for HIV infection, that is against retrovirus, that's why it's called antiretroviral drugs. And the examples include abacavir, then sidovudine, lamivudine, saquinavir, indinavir, nevirapine, etc. Now next we are going to the currently available drugs for the treatment of HIV infection, antiretroviral drugs. So among that, the first category is nucleoside or nucleotide reverse transcriptase inhibitors, example abacavir, then lamivudine, sidovudine, stavudine. So they will mainly inhibit the reverse transcriptase enzyme. So when the viral RNA that incorporate into host cell, they will transcribe their RNA into DNA by the help of reverse transcriptase enzyme. So this reverse transcriptase inhibitors will inhibit this enzyme. As a result, they can't convert their viral RNA into DNA. Okay, so there are nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors, which are analogs of different nucleoside or nucleotide. Example, sidovudine. It is a thymidine analog. And there are some non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors. They are not analogs of any nucleoside or nucleotide. Example, nevirapine, etravirine, etc. Then the third classification of third category is protease inhibitors. Example, intine hour, saccharin hour, etc. So this protease enzyme is required for viral maturation. So by inhibiting this protease enzyme, they will inhibit the viral maturation, the maturation of virus. The third category is fusion inhibitors, example enfuvirtide and maraviroc. And these are mainly inhibit fusion of host and viral cell membrane. As a result, virus cannot enter into the cell. Then the last category for the treatment of antiretroviral treatment is integrase inhibitor, raltegravir, and they will inhibit the integrase enzyme. As a result, the viral DNA cannot integrate or insert into host DNA. Usually into CD4 cell. Usually the viral DNA targets at CD4 cells of our immune system. So by inhibiting the integrase enzyme, they cannot integrate or incorporate or insert the viral DNA into DNA of CD4 cell. Usually in HIV, when the virus get incorporated into our cell, that will target some immune system cells. So usually this HIV virus, they mainly target CD4 cells. That's why we are using CD4 count in HIV. So when this get affected, when the CD4 cells get affected, their number or their amount will get declined. So by inhibiting this integrase enzyme, they will inhibit the integration of viral DNA into CD4 cells DNA. So this is what about the classification of HIV treatment. And usually in HIV, a combination drug therapy is provided. Two nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors will be provided with one protease inhibitor. For example, cidovudin plus lamivudin plus ritonavir. And another method is combining two nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor with a known nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor. For example, cidovudin plus lamivudin plus nevirapine. This is the treatment approach for HIV. We are moving back to our question again. Tick the drug inhibiting viral reverse transcriptase. Option A, cidovudin. Option B, vidarabine. Option C, rimantadine. And option D, ganciclovir. So from the question, the drug inhibiting viral reverse transcriptase, among the option, only drug available for HIV treatment is cidovudin. So of course the answer will be cidovudin, and cidovudin is a nucleoside viral reverse transcriptase inhibitor. Then the second option is vidarabine. Vidarabine is mainly a anti-herpes drug that mainly active against herpes virus and herpes and cytomegalovirus virus, and mainly this is useful against herpes virus, especially herpes simplex and varicella zoster, etc. They mainly inhibit viral DNA synthesis. The third one is rimantadine. Rimantadine is an inhibitor of viral and coating, and it is mainly used for treating respiratory tract infection. They also interfere with the release of new virions. The fourth option is ganciclovir. Ganciclovir is also a drug which coming under the category of drugs against herpes and cytomegalovirus infection, and this ganciclovir is active against cytomegalovirus. So for the treatment of cytomegalovirus only this ganciclovir is used, and they will mainly inhibit viral DNA polymerase. So if you see one question regarding this cytomegalovirus, like their treatment, the option you can choose ganciclovir. So these are the four options, and the question, tick the drug inhibiting viral reverse transcriptase. The answer is cidovudin. Fourth question, the mechanism of carbidopa's action is, option A, stimulating the synthesis, release or reuptake of dopamine, option B, inhibition of DOPA decarboxylase, option C, stimulating dopamine receptors, option D, selective inhibition of catechol or methyl transferase. So this carbidopa is a drug that used for Parkinsonism. Okay, so Parkinsonism, it's associated with loss of dopaminergic neuron in the substantia nigra. Substantia nigra, it's a source of dopaminergic neurons. So in that region, there is loss of dopaminergic neuron. Parkinsonism is a progressive neurological disorder of muscle movement characterized by tremor, muscle rigidity, bradykinesia, then postural and gait abnormalities. Bradykinesia means slowness in initiating and carrying out voluntary movement. The main aim of drug therapy in Parkinsonism is restoring dopamine neurons in basal ganglia, and another aim is re-establishing the balance between excitatory cholinergic neuron and inhibitory dopaminergic neuron. In our brain, there is a balance between this cholinergic neurotransmission and dopaminergic neurotransmission. So in Parkinsonism, the dopaminergic neuron level is declined. So that will lead to an imbalance in their ratio. So another aim of Parkinsonism treatment is restoring this imbalance between cholinergic neurons and dopaminergic neuron. So coming to the classification, the first one, drugs affecting brain dopaminergic system, and the second one will be drugs affecting brain cholinergic system. So coming to the drugs affecting brain dopaminergic system, the first category is dopamine precursor, levodopa, and the second one, peripheral decarboxylase inhibitor, carbidopa and benzeracide, and then third category, dopaminergic agonist, example bromocriptine, ropinirole, then category 4, MAVO-B inhibitor, example selegiline, then the next category, COMT inhibitor, example entacapone, then next category, dopamine facilitator, example amantadine. The second approach is using some anticholinergic drugs, that means the drugs affecting brain cholinergic system. In that, the first category is central anticholinergic, example trihexyphenidyl or benzoxol, then bipyridine, etc. Then in that, the second category is some antihistamines, example orphenadrin and promethazine. Then here we know dopamine that cannot cross the blood-brain barrier. So the most commonly used drug is levodopa for the treatment of Parkinsonism. So this levodopa actively transport in central nervous system and convert into dopamine in the brain. But this levodopa, when we are administering a large amount of levodopa, have to be consumed, just because much of the drug is decarboxylated into dopamine in the periphery. So that will resulting in large amount of dopamine in the periphery also, and that will lead to a lot of side effects like nausea, vomiting, cardiac arrhythmia, hypotension, etc. In order to inhibit or prevent this peripheral decarboxylation of levodopa, we are co-administering carbidopa with levodopa. And we know the effect of levodopa in CNS can be enhanced by co-administering carbidopa. Carbidopa is a DOPA decarboxylase inhibitor that does not cause blood-brain barrier, and that will diminish the metabolism of levodopa in gastrointestinal tract and peripheral tissues, that thereby it will increase the availability of levodopa in CNS. And the additional use is that will help to reduce the dose of levodopa. That's the second advantage of carbidopa. So in carbidopa, the two important points. First one, it will prevent the peripheral decarboxylation of levodopa. Second advantage of carbidopa is carbidopa lower the dose of levodopa required by 4 to 5 fold and decrease the severity of side effects arising from the peripherally formed dopamine. And levodopa along with carbidopa is a potent and efficacious drug regimen currently available to treat the Parkinson's disease. Carbidopa-levodopa combinations are usually available at 1:10 or 1:4 ratio of carbidopa to levodopa. Please remember the ratio. It's very important because that can be asked in various exams. The ratio is 1:10 or 1:4. Example, in marketly available drugs, Sindopa 110 that contain 10 milligram carbidopa and 100 milligram levodopa. The ratio is 1:10. Another example is Sindopa Plus, which contain 25 milligram carbidopa and 100 milligram levodopa. 1:4 ratio. So don't forget to remember the ratio. It's very important question that can be asked. So the ratio of carbidopa to levodopa is 1:4. Carbidopa in 1 and levodopa in 4 quantities. The ratio is 1:10 and 1:4. Please remember. We are going back to the question. The mechanism of carbidopa's action is inhibition of DOPA decarboxylase. Thereby, it will prevent the peripheral decarboxylation of levodopa and it will reduce the dose of levodopa by 4 to 5 fold reduction. And the third one important point is that will reduce the or decrease the side effects that occurs by peripheral dopamine concentration. And the fourth important point, always remember the ratio of carbidopa to levodopa, that is 1:10 or 1:4. Question in this session is, propranolol is used in the treatment of all of the following disease except option A, cardiovascular disease, option B, hyperthyroidism, option C, migraine headache, and option D, bronchial asthma. So there are different types of adrenoreceptors are there, like alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3. And this propranolol is a non-selective beta blocker that can either block beta 1 or beta 2. And before going to the discussion, we can see what are the different types of adrenoreceptors and what's the effect when a drug binds to these receptors. Usually this alpha 1 receptors, they are mainly when a drug binds to this receptor that will lead to vasoconstriction, increased peripheral resistance, increased blood pressure, mydriasis, increased closure of internal sphincter of the bladder. And this alpha 1 receptors, they are mainly found in post-junctional region. And the alpha 2 receptors, they are mainly seen in pre-junctional nerve endings. And they mainly act by inhibiting norepinephrine release, inhibit acetylcholine release, and also inhibit insulin release. So this is all about alpha receptors. And the next one is beta receptors. And beta receptors, there is beta 1 receptor, beta 2 receptor, and beta 3 receptor. Beta 3 receptor is found only in adipose tissue and mainly associated with lipolysis action. And the main important receptors in beta category is beta 1 and beta 2 receptors. And beta 1 receptor, that's mainly located in heart and kidney, and beta 2 mainly located in lungs. And the main actions of beta 1 include tachycardia, increased lipolysis, increased myocardial contractility, and increased release of renin. and the beta 2 receptor, when a drug binds to beta 2 receptor, the changes that occurring is vasodilation and slightly decreased peripheral resistance, bronchodilation, increased muscle and liver glycogenolysis, increased release of glucagon, relaxed uterine smooth muscle. This is all about alpha and beta receptors, and there are some drugs which will potentiate the action of this receptor. So when a drug binds to beta 2 receptor, for example some beta 2 agonist, that will lead to bronchodilation or vasodilation. And there are some drugs which opposes this action of this receptors, for example antagonist. I will take one example of beta 2 antagonist, and if agonist make bronchodilation in beta 2 receptor, antagonist make bronchoconstriction. Okay, so that is the difference between agonist and antagonist. Now we are going to beta blockers, because in this the question is mainly about propranolol. So propranolol is a non-selective beta antagonist, so they can either act on beta 1 receptor or in beta 2 receptor, that depends. And in beta blockers, the classification, first category is non-selective beta blocker. They can either beta act on beta 1 or on beta 2. And among that, the first category is without any intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. Example, propranolol, sotalol, timolol. Option B, with intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. Example, pindolol. That means they have some sympathomimetic activity along with this antagonistic activity. Example, pindolol. And note this point, question may ask like beta blocker with intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. So the answer is pindolol. The third category is with additional alpha blocking property. So along with this beta blocking activity, some drugs have some alpha blocking activity also. Example, labetalol and carvedilol. The second classification category is cardioselective beta blockers. So as I already said, beta 1 receptors are mainly present in heart. So these are cardioselective blockers. So they mainly beta 1 antagonist. Example, metoprolol, atenolol, acebutolol, bisoprolol, esmolol, bitaxolol, nebivolol, etc. And here one more point I would like to say is, please note the brand name of propranolol is very important in general, that can be asked in some questions. So please note that interal. And there are some drugs which opposes this action of this receptors, for example antagonist. I will take one example of beta 2 antagonist, and if agonist make bronchodilation in beta 2 receptor, antagonist make bronchoconstriction. Okay, so that is the difference between agonist and antagonist. Now we are going to beta blockers, because in this the question is mainly about propranolol. So propranolol is a non-selective beta antagonist. So they can either act on beta 1 receptor or in beta 2 receptor, that depends. And in beta blockers, the classification, first category is non-selective beta blocker. They can either beta act on beta 1 or on beta 2. And among that, the first category is without any intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. Example, propranolol, sotalol, timolol. Option B, with intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. Example, pindolol. That means they have some sympathomimetic activity along with this antagonistic activity. Example, pindolol. And note this point, question may ask like beta blocker with intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. So the answer is pindolol. The third category is with additional alpha blocking property. So along with this beta blocking activity, some drugs have some alpha blocking activity also. Example, labetalol and carvedilol. The second classification category is cardioselective beta blockers. So as I already said, beta 1 receptors are mainly present in heart. So these are cardioselective blockers. So they mainly beta 1 antagonist. Example, metoprolol, atenolol, acebutolol, bisoprolol, esmolol, bitaxolol, nebivolol, etc. So one more thing I want to remember you guys is Interal is the brand name for propranolol. It's important because that can be asked in questions. Now I am going to discuss about the pharmacological actions of propranolol. It's a non-selective beta blocker and the first action is cardiovascular. That's a beta blocker and that will diminish the cardiac output. It has both negative inotropic and chronotropic effect. That means it will decrease the heart rate and cardiac output. And the second action, peripheral vasoconstriction. We know in beta, it's a beta 2 blocker also. So beta 2 receptor, the main action is vasodilation. So propranolol, by blocking it, propranolol cause vasoconstriction. So propranolol will cause peripheral vasoconstriction. Third action is bronchoconstriction. Usually beta 2 receptor, it mainly cause bronchodilation and propranolol by blocking this beta 2 receptor cause bronchoconstriction. So here the main point you have to notice is propranolol should not be used in COPD or asthma patients. Fourth point is propranolol increase sodium retention. So thereby always provide a diuretic with propranolol in order to prevent this sodium retention, because this propranolol reduces the blood pressure and that will lead to decreased renal perfusion and then that will cause increased sodium retention and plasma volume. So that will cause edema. So always provide a diuretic with propranolol. And the fifth action is disturbance in glucose metabolism, because the beta 2 receptor has an action on this glucose metabolism. That means they will increase the muscle and liver glycogenolysis and increased release of glucagon. So by blocking this beta 2 receptor, they will decrease glycogenolysis. So they will decrease glucagon secretion. So when we are giving insulin and when we are co-administering propranolol with it, there will be a chance for hypoglycemia. A pronounced hypoglycemic case will be reported. So that's important. Again, there's an important point with this propranolol is that will cause hypoglycemia, that will interfere with glucose metabolism. And the main uses of propranolol include, first one, it's used in hypertension as it decreases the blood pressure. Then use is, propranolol is used as a prophylactic agent for the treatment of migraine, that I already explained in my previous presentation of migraine treatment. Please refer the same. And the third use of propranolol is, it's used in hyperthyroidism or thyroid storm. So that's an important point because question may ask like the beta blocker used for hyperthyroidism or not, the point thyroid storm. So the answer is propranolol. Please remember that point. And the fourth use is angina pectoris, because propranolol reduces the oxygen requirement of myocardium. And the another use is myocardial infarction, because propranolol has a protective effect on myocardium. And the another use is glaucoma. Propranolol reduces the intraocular tension by reducing the production of aqueous humor. So that can be used in glaucoma also. So the main uses of propranolol include hypertension, migraine, hyperthyroidism or thyroid storm, angina pectoris, myocardial infarction and glaucoma. And the main ADR associated with this propranolol is, first one and important one is bronchoconstriction. As I said earlier, it is contraindicated in patients with COPD or asthma condition. And the second one is hypoglycemia, that can interfere with glucose metabolism. So the second adverse effect is hypoglycemia. And the third one is that can also cause arrhythmia. When we are using this propranolol, then use is, propranolol is used as a prophylactic agent for the treatment of migraine, that I already explained in my previous presentation of migraine treatment. Please refer the same. And the third use of propranolol is, it's used in hyperthyroidism or thyroid storm. So that's an important point, because question may ask like the beta blocker used for hyperthyroidism or not the point, thyroid storm. So the answer is propranolol. Please remember that point. And the fourth use is angina pectoris, because propranolol reduce the oxygen requirement of myocardium. And the another use is myocardial infarction, because propranolol has a protective effect on myocardium. And the another use is glaucoma. Propranolol reduce the intraocular tension by reducing the production of aqueous humor. So that can be used in glaucoma also. So the main uses of propranolol include hypertension, migraine, hyperthyroidism or thyroid storm, angina pectoris, myocardial infarction and glaucoma. And the main ADR associated with this propranolol is, first one and important one is bronchoconstriction. As I said earlier, it is contraindicated in patients with COPD or asthma condition. And the second one is hypoglycemia, that can interfere with glucose metabolism. So the second adverse effect is hypoglycemia. And the third one is that can also cause arrhythmia. When withdrawal of propranolol after chronic use should be gradual, otherwise it can cause rebound hypertension or it can worsen the condition angina. Okay, so this point should be remembered. In case of propranolol, the point you have to remember, first one, it's a non-selective beta blocker. Second one, it should not be used in patients with asthma or COPD. Then third one, it causes hypoglycemia. Fourth one, withdrawal of propranolol after chronic use should be gradual, otherwise it will cause rebound hypertension or it can worsen the angina condition. So that's all about propranolol. Now we can go back again to the question. Propranolol is used in the treatment of all of the following disease except option A, cardiovascular disease. Propranolol is used in hypertension, angina, myocardial infarction, etc. The second option, hyperthyroidism. Propranolol is a very good drug for hyperthyroidism or thyroid storm. And the third one, migraine headache. Propranolol is using prophylactically for the treatment of migraine. And the last point is bronchial asthma. Propranolol should not be used in bronchial asthma. So the answer is bronchial asthma. This is all about today's presentation. And thank you for watching this video. And if you have any doubt, you can comment that in the comment box given below. Do watch my channel and support. Thank you.